Dear students, Assalamu alaikum. I am Matiullah Khattak, teaching you English. The necessary introduction to the lesson has been well made. Now you need to understand the speech word by word, sentence by sentence in detail. So give a close attention to the reading and explanation. Our objectives for this lecture, for this lessons, are the same. So keep these objectives in mind and try to achieve them at all possible cost. These are possible only if you give your due attention, close attention. So at the end of this lesson, you must be able to know about the life of Martin Luther and his achievements, the ups and downs experienced by the American society, that civil rights belong to every individual living in a society, discrimination on the basis of a race detrimental to the progress of a society. Endeavor for a great cause requires passion and tolerance. We had discussed these objectives in the previous lecture, so they are the same. Now let us move to the actual text of the dream. I have a dream, Martin Luther King Jr. He says to the crowd, 50 years ago, a great American, and whose symbolic shadow we stand, signed the Emancipation Proclamation. This momentous decree came as a great beacon light of hope to millions of Negro slaves who had been seared in the flames of withering injustice. It came as a joyous daybreak to end the long night of captivity. But 100 years later, we must face the tragic fact that the Negro still is not free. 100 years later, the life of the Negro is still sadly crippled by the manacles of segregation and the chains of discrimination. 100 years later, the Negro lives on a lonely island of poverty in the midst of a vast ocean of material prosperity. 100 years later, the Negro is still languished in the corners of American society and finds himself as an exile in his own land. So we have come here today to dramatize an appalling condition. In a sense, we have come to our nation's capital to cash a check. When the architects of our republic wrote the magnificent words of the Constitution and the Declaration of Independence, they were signing a promissory note to which every American was to fall heir. This note was a promise that all men would be guaranteed the unalienable rights of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. So after going through the paragraph, you must have realized that Martin Luther in his speech is giving a lot of emphasis upon one point, and that point is that 100 years later they have not been given their basic rights or civil rights or the rights to life. So he wants to prick the conscience of the white American that they need their rights so much. Let us see if there is anything you find difficult. 50 years ago, when he says 50 years ago, it means 100 years ago. So 1 score is equal to 20 years. A score is equal to 20 years long period. Why does he say 5 score years ago? As I told you in the previous lecture, that the president of the USA called Abraham Lincoln, he had signed an emancipation proclamation, a declaration of independence for the black people, that they should be given their due rights equal to anyone living here in this state. So, and that was signed, as I told you, in 1863. And this speech, which is made by Martin Luther, is in 1963. So, 100 years ago, 5 score years ago, a great American, it is a phrase, praising phrase, which is used to refer when he says, great American, it is a praising phrase. It is called an epithet, E-P-I-T-H-E-T. It is an epithet that is used for the President Abraham Lincoln, very much like we people use the great leader for Muhammad Ali Jinnah. We use the great leader or Qaid-e-Azam. Similarly, he is using this epithet, this praising phrase, this name, which is a substitute for his actual name. So it refers to Abraham Lincoln, in whose symbolic shadow we stand. When he says symbolic shadow, he refers to the Lincoln Memorial, as I told you in the previous lecture, where you saw the Lincoln Memorial. This is the Lincoln Memorial, and there is also the statue of this great American. When he says in whose symbolic shadow, the symbolic shadow refers to the Lincoln Memorial and the statue that were built there. And from the steps of this memorial, he was delivering the speech to the crowd of people extending in front of him. So when he says symbolic shadow, he means to say that although he is not physically present among us on this occasion, but symbolically he is represented by this memorial and this statue, and we stand here united under his leadership. So this is the whole explanation of this phrase. Symbolic shadow means, although he is not present physically among us today, but symbolically he is represented by this memorial and this statue, and we stand united under his leadership. Signed the Emancipation Proclamation. This man, this great American, signed the Emancipation Proclamation. He, the Declaration of Independence for us, the Emancipation Proclamation, as I told you in the previous lecture, the liberation, the freedom announcement was made by this great American. So it was, when he proceeds further in his speech, he tells them that this momentous decree, very important order. So it was a very important order for what kind of people? For the black Americans, because they had been under slavery and hatred for a very long period of time, and they were feeling it a very big necessity to get freedom, to get justice, to get jobs, to get opportunity. So that's why he tells them, this momentous decree came a great beacon light of hope. This very historic, very important order was a ray of hope. Beacon light of hope is an idiom which means a ray of hope. Umeed ki kiran thi, to millions of Negro slaves. So basically they were leading life like slaves, and they were not only in 100 or 1,000, they were in millions, who had been seared in the flames of withering injustice, who had been, these Negro had been burned. Seared means to become blackened by heat or burning. So they had been burned or blackened in the flames of what? Withering injustice. Withering injustice here means extreme sort of injustice was done to them, meted out to them. That's why he says we were burning in injustices of the society. So it came is a joyous daybreak. It here refers to this Emancipation Proclamation. This Emancipation Proclamation was a joyous daybreak, was a joyful sunrise. Daybreak means start of the day, sunrise, because it ended the long night of captivity, slavery. When you are in the state of slavery, you are under captivity. So it was a long night of captivity. It came to an end. How? When this Emancipation Proclamation was signed by the great American. Now he reminds them, when he repeats this phrase again and again, he wants to remind the people concerned, the people in authority, that a period of 100 years has passed, but we have not been given our due rights, our citizenship's rights. So, but 100 years later, we must face the tragic fact, this horrible fact that the Negro is still not free, that we are not free even today, 100 years later. So he is repeating this sentence, this phrase, again and again, in order to make it visible, to make it clear, to make it understand by them that they need it so much. 100 years later, the life of the Negro is still sadly crippled by the manacles of segregation. Sadly crippled is terribly crippled, crushed by the manacles. Manacles refers to handcuffs. You can see over here, shackles, handcuffs, which are used to chain a person if he is culprit. So sadly crippled, they are to the state of being very sad, crushed by the manacles of segregation. They are under the chains of racial injustice. Segregation simply means separation on the basis of differentiation, separation on the basis of being a different race. And the chains of discrimination and segregation, they have the same meanings. 100 years later, the Negro lives on a lonely island of poverty in the midst of a vast ocean of material prosperity. Lonely island of poverty and material prosperity. These are two contrasting phrases. In the surrounding vast ocean of material prosperity, in the surrounding you can see that other people are enjoying all the facilities of life. They are enjoying the material prosperity, all the facilities that one should get while living in a particular country. But only a small piece of land, a lonely island of poverty, it refers to the area where they were living. So this is a very small piece of land where are living people who are suffering from the state of poverty. So he reminds them that on a lonely island in the midst of a vast ocean. So there is a big vast ocean where everything is available for everyone living here, but only a piece of land is like that where people are not given their due rights. So 100 years later, the Negro is still languished languished under bad condition, under miserable condition. When you are weakened, when you are sick, you are suffering from sickness or weakness, you are languished. So they were 100 years later, the Negro is still languished. They are still in bad condition, in the state of sickness or weakness, in the corners of American society. Even though they are living in the same society, but they have been pushed to the corners, to the slum areas, to the ghettos of American society, and they are not given their rights. And they find himself in exile. Exile means one who is banished from his own country is called in exile. Banished means one who is expelled from his own country. So they are leading a life very much like an exile, very much like a person who has been banished from his own country, jisko jalavatan kehte hain, in his own land. So this is their own country, but they are living like they are in exile. So we have come here today to dramatize an appalling condition. So he tells them that we have come here to make show off. To dramatize means to make something public, to make something known to all. An appalling condition, horrifying condition, frightening condition, bad condition, miserable condition that we are living under, miserable condition, and we want to make it known to the whole world today. That's why we have come over here. So he further tells them that in a sense we have come to our nation's capital. In a sense, you can say that we have come to our nation's capital to cash a check. We have come here to get a check to the capital, Washington, D.C. We want to cash our check, to get our rights. When the architects of our republic wrote the magnificent words of the Constitution, so here he refers to the Constitution of the country, when the architects, the builders of this nation, of this republic, of this democratic setup, of this democratic country, wrote the magnificent words of the Constitution, when they were writing the Constitution and the Declaration of Independence, and when they got independence, they were signing a promissory note. So they were making a promise, and they were putting their signs on that promise that each and everyone living in America will fall heir, will be given the rights, will be given the citizenship rights, will be given the basic rights, will be given the civil rights. So he is reminding them, when they were writing this Constitution, they were making a promise and they were putting their sign to which every American was to fall heir. Every American has the right to get these rights according to this promissory note, according to this promise. This note was a promise. It was a promise with all men living here in America. All men would be guaranteed the unalienable, not transferable, that cannot be transferred to any other one, that cannot be separated. Which rights? The rights of life. They were making a promise that all men would be guaranteed the unalienable rights of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. So, in simple words, we can say it was a promise that everyone living here in America has been given this right, that he should spend his life along with all the basic rights. He will be free to do what he wants to do, and he will have the right to spend his life with happiness. So the next paragraph, in this paragraph he continues with the same tone and reminds them that we are here today in order to get our rights at any cost. So let us give a reading to the paragraph, it is obvious today that America has defaulted on this promissory note. And so far as her citizens of color are concerned, instead of honoring this sacred obligation, America has given the Negro people a bad check, a check which has returned comeback marked insufficient funds. But we refuse to believe that the Bank of Justice is bankrupt. We refuse to believe that there are insufficient funds in the great vaults of opportunity of this nation. So we have come to cash this check, a check that will give us upon demand the riches of freedom and the security of justice. We have also come to this hallowed spot to remind America the fierce urgency of now. This is no time to engage in the luxury of cooling off or to take the tranquilizing of gradualism. Now is the time to make real the promises of democracy. Now is the time to rise from the dark and desolate valley of segregation to the sunlit path of racial justice. Now is the time to open the doors of opportunity to all of God's children. Now is the time to lift our nation from the quicksand of racial injustice to the solid rock of brotherhood. So now let us see the important points. He tells them that it is very clear, it is very obvious that America has defaulted. America has failed. Defaulted means failed on this promissory note. What promise they had made with the whole nation, they have failed in to carry out that promise. And so far as her citizens of color are concerned, so far as it is concerned with the citizen of color, color means black people are concerned, instead of honoring this sacred obligation, responsibility, honoring, respecting, fulfilling. So instead of honoring this sacred obligation, which obligation? The obligation of giving their due rights. They have not honored, they have not respected, they have not regarded this sacred obligation. America has given the Negro people a bad check. The people of America have given the black people a bad check. A bad check means a check which has returned, come back, marked insufficient funds. And the check is marked that we have no funds for you, insufficient funds, we are lacking in funds. So the check was given back by the American authority that we have no funds for you. It means that we have nothing for you. We do not have any good considerations for you. We do not have any funds for you, rights for you. We cannot give your rights. So, but we refuse to believe. Martin Luther tells them that we do not believe in this, that the Bank of Justice is bankrupt. That this bank, which has to provide justice to all, which had made a promise that each and everyone will get equal rights, is bankrupt. Is bankrupt means insolvent. Insolvent means when a country is not in position to pay back the money they have taken from some bank, they have taken from another country. So bankrupt means devalia hona. If you are not in position to pay back the money, the debt you have taken from a country or a bank. So he tells them that we cannot believe that the Bank of Justice, that this country which is responsible to pay, to give justice to each and everyone living here, is not in this position to pay it. We refuse to believe, and we cannot believe that there are insufficient funds in the great vaults of opportunity of this nation. So they wanted opportunities, jobs for themselves as well. So he tells them that we are not going to believe in this as a fact that the great words, that the great treasure of opportunity has nothing to give to the black people, to the colored people. Words means treasure of opportunity of this nation are empty completely for the colored people. We are not going to believe it. So we have come to cash this check. We have to cash this check at all cost. A check that will give us upon demand. This check will give us what? The riches of freedom, the wealth of freedom, riches of freedom, wealth of freedom, and the security of justice. And we will get justice, and we will get justice in this society. We have also come to this hallowed spot. Hallowed spot refers to this Lincoln Memorial, this part of Washington DC, where from he is making this speech. He calls it hallowed spots. Hallowed means that this sacred, this holy, this pious place, spot, place. We have come to this hallowed spot. We have come to this pious, this sacred, this holy place to remind America and the fierce, and the fierce urgency of now, that it the extreme urgency need of the day. We cannot wait anymore. He tells them that it is the fierce urgency of now. It is extremely needed by us, and we cannot wait for it anymore. This is no time to engage in the luxury of cooling off or to take the tranquilizing of gradualism. It is not good time that we get engaged in what? In the luxury, comfort, pleasant feeling. He wants to tell them that you need not to think any more pleasant and you comfortable, and that they need to wait a bit more. We cannot wait anymore, as he has told them. It is the fierce urgency of now. You do not need to get yourself engaged in the luxury of cooling off. Cooling off simply means to make somebody cool down, that you need to wait a bit more to make somebody calm down, to make somebody peaceful, that you need to wait a bit more. So he tells them it is not the time to make us cool off or to take the tranquilizing of gradualism. Tranquilizing means peacefulness, calmness, that you need to take a tranquilizing of gradualism. You need to wait a bit more. Tranquilizing is, I have told you, is to make somebody peaceful, to give somebody the feeling to feel calm. So you need to wait a bit more. He tells them now is the time to make real the promises of democracy. This is high time. It is good time that you should make real the promises which you had made. Now is the time to rise from the dark and desolate valley of segregation. Now it is the time to leave this desolate, gloomy, miserable valley, poor condition of segregation, this racial differences. So we need to get out of this darkness, this gloomy condition of racial segregation, into the sunlit path of racial justice, to the peaceful path, sunlit path, the peaceful path of racial justice, where every race gets justice. Now is the time to open the doors of opportunity to all God's children. All God's children, all those who are living in America, they should be given opportunity, provided with opportunity, so the door should be open to all of them. Now is the time to lift our nation from the quicksand of racial injustice to the solid rock of brotherhood. So it is a good time, it is a high time. We need to get our nation quicksand, wet sand, from is dal dal se hame inko nikalna chahiye from the wet sand, the sand where they have got stuck. We need to get them from this wet sand, from this quicksand where they are suffering from racial injustice. We need to bring them to the solid rock, to the strong position, solid rock, strong position, united position of brotherhood, where they should stand as brother and sister. It would be fatal for the nation to overlook the urgency of the moment and to underestimate the determination of the Negro. This sweltering summer, it would be fatal for the nation. It would be very dangerous for the nation to overlook, to neglect, ignore the urgency of the moment. It is very, very great, very, very urgent thing to do, very urgent moment to be considered. And to underestimate means to misjudge the determination of the Negro. They should not misjudge our determination, our firmness, our resolution, our resoluteness. It should not be underestimated, misjudged, or belittled. This sweltering summer of the Negro's legitimate discontent will not pass until there is an invigorating autumn of freedom and equality. So this sweltering summer, this sweltering, sweltering is, as I had told you, this withering summer, this burning summer, they are burning because of what? Because they are not given their legitimate rights. This discontent, dissatisfaction among them is legitimate, is not illegitimate, it is legitimate, is legal, and it will not pass until they are given their due rights. Invigorating autumn. Invigorating means animating, vitalizing. So they are passing through a period of autumn, but this autumn will give them a lot of energy, a lot of vitality. It will animate them for what? For freedom and equality. 1963, on this day this speech was made, is not an end. So he tells them this is not the end, but a beginning. It is the beginning. Those who hope that the Negro needed to blow off steam means to release anger. So he refers to those people who think that the Negro now need to blow off steam. They need to release their anger, will be content, will have a root awakening if the nation returns to business as usual. So there are some people who think that they need to blow off steam. They will now be content. They refer to the black American that they need to release their anger and then they will be satisfied. Content means satisfied. He tells them, Martin Luther tells them, that they will have a rude awakening. When they get up the next morning, they will have unpleasant situation as compared to this one if they return to business as usual, because the black American will come to this business and they will make it a routine for them. There will be neither rest nor tranquility in America. There will be no peacefulness, tranquility, calmness, peacefulness in America until the Negro is granted his citizenship rights, until they are given their rights. The whirlwinds, you know, the storms of revolt will continue. It will continue to shake the foundation of our nation. It will keep shaking the foundation, the basis of our nation, until the bright day of justice emerges, rises. Until the bright day of justice rises or emerges. I think you got the main points. Try to understand, give close attention to the paragraphs and explanation, and ask your question if you carry any in your mind. Thank you very much.